Hey, folks, Landstryder here, and welcome back to another episode of Diary of a Technowizard. Playing the Unabridged Modpack on the Primus server with lots of cool folks. Of course, actually, Thorgal's on right now. I've been running into too many people lately because I've been playing at weird hours. Last episode, we were talking about getting our Thomic Energistics getting going, and I was reproducing quartz. Using glass. In fact, I should have another big batch of glass down here ready to go. Yeah, quite a bit of it. Now I've got quartz glass from Ender.io, but that can easily be converted back into vanilla glass by just putting it in a crafting grid. Really easy to do. And if you want to get the vanilla glass into quartz glass, quite clear glass, what I meant to say, sorry. If you want to convert it back into quite clear glass, you can do that in chisel. Pretty nice, back and forth. But I need the vanilla glass because it's got the aspect that I'm looking for. So we're going to go ahead and fill up our hopper over here. And put some more of that in there. It's going to give us a bunch more. I set up yet another alchemical furnace so that I would be able to get all the other aspects for doing different infusions, and I'd have one that I would just be able to throw whatever I needed to throw in and cook it down. I don't need that extra pan, so let's clear that. Is there any of the other ones? No. What I did, to get my Tudemon in order to make my warning focus. Because I just took that filing cabinet full of all the magic armors and stuff like that that were down that I was getting from the zombies originally, and I just cooked down a whole bunch of that, and I've got a bunch of Panis, a bunch of Tudemon, I got Bestia from it, and a little bit of Perdito, or Precantatio, I meant to say. Okay. Other changes, let's see. Up here, I've got myself an elven gate now. Isn't this nice? I like it. I like that. I like rounding the corners off with some carpenter blocks, because it does make it look a lot nicer than just having those corners open like you could. You could just fill them in with square blocks too, but I like the nice rounded look of that. So, what I did is, after I put my agglomeration plate together last episode, I made myself a terrasteel. I only really need one. You need one terrasteel. After you get your agglomeration plate, you know, you put your three different things on there. You really need the spark in order to make terrasteel, because a mana distributor is not going to get mana into this thing fast enough before the items despawn that are on top of it. So, now fortunately, I've got those four mana pools back there can reach this, and these two mana pools over here can also reach it. So I've got six mana pools that can feed this thing if I want to make a piece of terrasteel. Don't really need any right this moment, so. Let's see, and then you can see how that I added a aspect to the spark. This one is recessive, and what that means is it will look around at all the other mana pools, and it'll try to push mana into all the other mana pools first, which is perfect because this is the one that I'm measuring whether or not I need to generate mana. So it will push its mana into the other mana pools, and this will be the one that has the least amount of mana in it, no matter what, because of that spark, or because of that extra aspect on the spark. I don't think I mentioned it. I actually did this a little bit ago, but this mana pool has the conjuration catalyst on it, so that I can actually duplicate things like nether quartz and glowstone. I think there's a few other things that you can duplicate with it. It's really convenient, so I pretty much have an endless supply of nether quartz for my upcoming foray into Thomic Energistics. So I won't have to worry about running out of nether quartz. I also use that to duplicate nether quartz if I want to put sharpness on one of my blades or something like that, or one of my weapons. So I might do that eventually, and I don't have to go running around the nether looking for it. Okay, and then over here, this maniple is within range of this spark right here. The problem is this far one is too far away for that one to push mana all the way over here. So what I did is on this one, I put a dominant spark. And what that's going to do is the only mana pool that's in range is this one. But what it does is it will suck the mana from this mana pool. And since that one keeps this mana pool full, this one, these two will fill up from the main mana source over there. For now, I may eventually add some more mana generation up here. Or if I do, though, I'm going to go with something a little bit different. Because these are nice, but they are definitely not the best. And if you have more than just a few of these, they will definitely cause some serious TPS issues on a server. So you don't want to have more than like a handful of these. Like we did some experiments way back, and I know that Vasky added some stuff that did improve the problem, but massive amounts of generating flowers will definitely cause TPS problems on a server. So I'm going to try to not cause those issues from here. Since this is loaded all the time and that is doing its thing all the time. If it's only loaded when you're on, then it may not be as big of an issue. But the other thing is that this mana spreader really can only handle these four flowers unless I moved it closer, which I really don't want to do. I like where it's at. So yeah, I'm going to look at doing another form of mana generation soon, just to experiment. And actually, I did do one form of mana generation that I experimented with, and it really didn't come out very well. I made a Taint Thistle. Really not too hard. It's an arcane infusion, takes just a little bit of aspect, and a Taint Tendril, which I actually had one from I don't know where. Probably got it from a boss mob. I think I still have a couple of them. I could make another one if I wanted to. And what I did, we'll come all the way down here, and we'll get our portable hole. We'll drop down out of the base. When we come down here and look, I had the Taint Thistle directly underneath this mana spreader. And I had a cobble generator, one of those magic cobble generators, spitting cobble into this crucible, which was creating flux, you know, and goo. And gash. In fact, there's still some gas up there that I didn't ever finally got rid of. I should probably get rid of it. I don't know if I can. I could suck it up. Oh, there's still some up here, too. Oh, that's annoying. Now I'm crooked. There we go. Anyway, I'll get rid of that some other time. But the Taint Thistle would allow... was basically what I was going to use for my mana generation down here. There was two problems with that. Two big problems with that. One, the Taint Thistle only generates a very minuscule amount of mana from the taint that you put into it. Like, you could drop like 10 stacks of material in your crucible and, you know, have the taint flowing out of it. The thistle will suck it all up, no problem, but it'll only make a very small amount of mana from that material. So really not efficient. Very not efficient. The other problem is that the flower just completely disappeared after about 3 in-game days, which kind of follows along the passive generation update. So I'm not sure. It doesn't really... The Taint Thistle doesn't really follow or doesn't really fit into the passive generation definition. Because it uses a resource. So it should not be passive. But apparently it's set to passive, or it's set to... it basically disappeared after a little bit. And that was not too happy about that. But so let's look over here. The reason I wanted the mana generation down here, the trickle of mana generation down here, is really... And it would have worked, because I'm not using a ton of mana down here, is I've got myself the... Jaded Amaranthus, which is attached to that mana pole, sucking a little bit of mana and creating lots of Botania flowers. I've also made myself a Drum of the Wild. Is there a way to open Oh, yeah, cool. If I hover over, I can open it straight up with a recipe if I press R. I've tried that before, but it doesn't usually work for me. So, yeah, that's just a Horn of the Wild, which is a dungeon with a pasture seed and some stuff. Some living wood. And more living wood and some leather makes the drum. The drum will activate whenever it gets hit by a mana pulse. And over here, you can see I've got a redstone mana spreader, which only sends mana on a redstone pulse. Let me throw these flowers out. And to do that redstone pulse, I'm using the Magic Hourglass from Automagi. This thing's awesome, and I really should be using this more instead of using the timers from the Blue Power. So I might go back and switch some of my timers from Blue Power, because this thing's very controllable, and it can be set to, like, you can set it up to a bunch of minutes. I think it's like 999 minutes or something like that. You can set it to repeat or not. You can have it respond differently when you send a signal to it. And it's very configurable. Oh goodness, there goes flowers again. Oh, I got all kinds of flowers. Flowers. So, it basically, I just set it to pulse once per minute. And it sends that pulse to the drum, which breaks the majority of the flowers that are around here. Okay, then what is picking those flowers up? I need to get out of here before it pulses again the next time. But what is picking those flowers up is this vacuum chest. Apparently I killed a witch nearby. The interface for this in my texture pack is all messed up, because obviously there has been an update to Ender.io, and my texture pack hasn't caught up yet. Sortex has not released a new one. So what I'll probably do later is I'll just go in and delete the Ender.io folder that contains the GUIs, and that should fix that GUI issue that I've just seen there. Oh, I didn't get out of here soon enough. Drop these flowers again. Okay. And these are all going into getting sucked into that chest, and then I'm pulling them out using an item conduit and bringing them over here to these drawers, these four drawers. So I got a total of 16 slots. There's 16 different colors. It's perfect. And then let me get open one of these up. You can see actually I got quite a good amount. In each one of these I have two storage upgrades of obsidian. So that means that they'll hold 10 times as much as a standard as the drawer would by standard, the normally. And then I also got a void upgrade in case it fills up beyond those 10 times whatever the normal amount of flowers that it could have. I think it's like 4 stacks or something like that. So it should be able to hold like 40 stacks each of the flowers. And it should just continue to do that, make flowers for me, and I'll have some whenever I need them, because I might need dyes. In fact, that's one of the reasons I made this system, is because I want some dyes for some Decocraft, which we're going to do here in just 1 second. And instead of having a mana generation system down here, I'll clean this up later. All I'm going to do is bring my mana tablet down here and put mana in here when I need flowers. So once this mana pool runs out, I should have enough flowers for a long time. And then if for any reason I need to get more flowers, I can always just bring some more mana down and throw my mana tablet on there. Charge up that mana pool for a little bit, and it'll run. All right. Got the rest of... Well, I've got 8 witches. I don't know if that's enough or not. This is plenty to keep my life pool filled, you know, for the passive usage that I use. And, you know, I could even go mining and stuff like that, and these guys will keep it pretty well filled. I don't know how it's going to do when I start to get into some heavy blood magic crafting and such, but we'll see. I also put this guy down here, the Serenade of the Nether, so whenever I need a bucket of lava, I can just come down here, grab a bucket of lava, and it'll always be there. There will always be a bucket of lava there, refilled from my blood network. All right, let's come back up here. And I moved everything from over that wall and brought it over here and added a bunch of stuff. So I got rid of all of the caches, all of the thermal expansion caches, and I went with storage drawers. So I've got the single storage doors here with emerald upgrades in all these. So that's 13 times the normal amount that they could hold. I think that's going to be enough. If I find that any of these start to get too full, I will just go ahead and put a void upgrade on them, because I don't think I need any more than, I don't know, what is that? The 32 times 13 stacks of material in each one of those drawers, I'm good. And then I also put emerald upgrades on all of my compression drawers. So, and then I moved my redstone, glowstone, lapis, diamonds, and coal. The coal was a big one because I had like tons and tons of that. And then all the metals. Not alloys, just the regular straight metals that I normally get out of the ground. And then I've set up a couple more drawers. I want to put upgrades on these, and then I want to put anything that I have a considerable amount of in the drawers. I want to put emerald upgrades on every one of these. And then I got another bank of drawers over here. Same way, I've got the double drawers at the bottom and the quad drawers the rest of the way up. Because what I'm going to do is, when I get my Applied Energistics system, I'm going to attach to this drawer controller. And it's worked out perfectly where I put it, because this is, it can scan up to 12 blocks. And that is exactly 12 blocks from that direction. And this is exactly 12 blocks in this direction. Whoops. I don't need no charcoal. No charcoal dust. And then this right here, the spruce trim. If we go down underneath, you'll be able to see exactly what it is. So right here, I've got spruce trim coming from this bank of drawers over to this bank of drawers, so that the drawer controller can see these guys across that gap. But I mean, it does kind of break the pattern of the floor, but that's okay. I will probably put something like tables, or I don't know that I'll have any more machines, but I might have extra machines, depending on how many recipes I set up, if I ever get around to doing auto-crafting with ME. The generator is back there. There's my remote storage still. This thing is going to go away eventually, because I am just so sick and tired of this thing flashing. It's not doing it right now, because there's nobody else on the server, hardly, or the other person that's on the server is probably not moving around or doing much. So, but whenever there's like, even if there's only like three people and one other person's doing anything, this thing just flashes like crazy, and it makes it really hard for you to get materials in and out of it while it's doing that. And of course, it's not going to do it while I'm recording. All right, let's, anything new on here that I didn't describe yet? I added a second stone generator to this, just so that it'll go a little bit quicker. Still a long way off from having an octuple and being able to make a bedrockium drum. The only thing I really want a bedrockium drum for is to store my experience. Because you can see this one's full, and I've got 80 levels. I got nowhere to put it right this minute. You know, what I should do right this moment, right this very second, is I should make an experience obelisk. Because that would solve this issue. I wouldn't need the drum. And then I could just get enough cobble to make my deep dark portal, and whatever else I might need cobble for, I'll have cobble. Let me do that. Let's get that experience obelisk I've talked about before. Obelisk, am I spelling it wrong? Probably, yes. Ender.io, we'll just look it up that way. There it is. Experience obelisk. So we're going to need experience rod, which is Enderium and Solarium. I don't think I have either of that. Let's see here. We're going to need some gold and some redstone and some glowstone. Glowstone. And I locked all these drawers, so even if I take the very last piece out, it will retain what is supposed to be in the drawer. So if I was still cooking sand, it's almost done. It's got like a couple pieces left. It's out of energy, though. It's low on energy, so let's... I'm also going to need some soul sand. I don't think I have soul sand in a drawer, do I? No. Soul sand. I need to go collect a bunch more of this, I think, because I use a bit of soul sand from time to time. And that's going to take some gold as well. There we go. Gold. Okay. Okay, stop. Stop that. You. What if I do this? Ah, well, let me do that. Okay, you. I had it automatically pulling and pushing into the chest above just to kind of automate that crafting a little bit. All right, so now pull that out of there. I don't know why it's pulling the quite clear glass back in. Apparently there is a there's some kind of alloy recipe that uses it. So that. That's going to give us our what is it called? The stuff, the energetic alloy. Then we're going to need to take that stuff out. Let's get some solarium. I'm gonna need like 2 for the rod, 3 for the machine. I'm also gonna need a capacitor and some iron bars and some iron. Okay. Not too bad. The capacitor is gonna be, there you go, see, it flashed. Not that bad right this moment, but it can get really nasty. Let's get some gold nuggets. Got the redstone, so I should be able to make the capacitor for this. I just need the one for now. This is the new one, a tractor obelisk. No, that's not new. Weather obelisk, that's the new one. And I don't know what that inhibitor. I think that's the one that stops things from spawning in the area. I need the iron and the iron bars. Get the iron bars and iron. Did that just put? Okay, good. You got to double click it in order to. There we go. Got that. Let's get our solarium. So now with this, we can make the experience rod. And I think this can actually hold experience. Yeah, right-click on a fluid tank containing liquid XP to gain levels. Shift-right-click to transfer levels to the tank. Okay. We don't need to do that, because we're going to make the obelisk. No? Let's try that again. Oh, this probably don't stack. Yeah, it's probably like a tool, so it doesn't stack. So there we go, there's our experience obelisk that looks all weird on our hotbar now. Very strange. Anyway, that's going to go over here. Like I said, this is eventually going to be the area. So now I can open this up and I can go store all my levels. And there it goes, it's got 80 levels in it. And it looks like, I don't know if that's the maximum amount that it can have there, and I'm not sure. Yeah, I can't get levels out of it like that, but I can do... What I can do is this. Conduit. I can take a fluid conduit. Because this will accept the liquid XP as fluid. And I can tell that to extract. Active. And it's going to start pumping levels in, or pumping the experience out of the drum over into the obelisk. And now I'll be able to store, I think, pretty much as much experience as I want in this obelisk. And I can pull it out one level at a time, I can pull it out 10 levels at a time, or I can just pull it all out if I want it. So yeah, once that's done, then I won't need that grate and that drum there anymore. I'll just use the obelisk for liquid experience. Basically, I can also pipe out of the obelisk if I need liquid experience for something else, like an auto enchanter or something like that. Alright, so I've gotten super distracted and way off of what I wanted to get done today. So let's get back on track a little bit here in a second. 1 second, I'll just throw this stuff in here. Get that out of my inventory. So yeah, I really want to get some Decocraft. The main thing is I want to replace those bars on top of there with some actual stuff that looks like chain. And then there's some other things from Decocraft that I might want to have around the base. So I think we'll do that. Well, first of all, I need to do it, and I need to put this together here. I'm going to have the colors in the right order. Let's see here. Nope. There it is. Deco bench. So this is the most important part. You gotta have a deco bench in order to craft all the Decocraft items. And we'll come up here and take a look at what I built on this level. I haven't showed this yet. I've done a couple things up here. First of all, I went and got a villager, and I made this trade station. I had to go borrow somebody's rolling machine in order to make the steel to make this thing. Because it's four steel plates, a dispenser, some emeralds, and some glass. And basically what this allows you to do is it allows you to automate the trading with villagers. Now the problem with this is it's really not intuitive about how it works. So, and plus the interface here is missing some buttons in my texture pack. So that made it a little extra confusing. So let's look at this top one, the raw chicken. I don't have any raw chicken, but if you, there's a button right here that's supposed to look like a dice that will allow you to switch around between the trades. And then over here, you can select the type of villager that you want to look for trades with. Right? So, you know, you start with this. I think this is basic farmer, librarian, I think. Thomcraft, maybe. The cook. Wait, what's the difference between this one and this one? One of those, I think that one might be the blacksmith, and this one's a cook. Railcraft guy. I don't know. Maybe that's the Thomcraft guy. That's definitely the open blocks guy. I don't know. That guy's like an engineer of some kind. That might be the immersive engineering guy. That's a witch from witchery, I think. I don't know. Again, might be the Thomcraft one. A priest. Maybe the bee guy. Forestry guy, I think. Maybe another forestry guy. I don't know. So there's a lot of different types of villagers. And then you can go... Yeah, that's definitely a Thomcraft guy right there. Oh, that's a forbidden magic guy. And then you can basically randomly go through and look for the trades. Now, once you find the trade that you want on the villager... Now, this interface has nothing to do with the actual villager that's over there. You find what you want and you select it. So here we've got wheat for emeralds, which is a trade that this guy actually has. Since he has wheat for emeralds, I can use this because he's within six blocks of the trade station. I can use this to automatically trade wheat for emeralds with him. And then once you get the trade that you want, you can actually adjust this number, because say if I had it like 50, if I only wanted to spend 15 wheat for one emerald, that would be okay as long as there is a villager nearby that actually has that trade. This guy doesn't have that trade. He has 21 wheat for one emerald. So this one has to match his trade in order to automate it. The other problem is it still follows the same limitations of actually trading with him. Once you do it a few times, it becomes locked and you have to do a different trade. So I'm hoping that eventually he'll have another trade that I also want that will gain me emeralds, and I'll be able to automate both of those. Either that, or I might go get another villager. You can see that I got another slot here for villager trading. But I just thought it was kind of neat. I wanted to finally figure out how to use this thing. And after some fiddling and some research, I did finally come up with how to use it. So there's that, and that's another 5 minutes of explanation and distraction. So here we go. The Void Vault. I thought it would be cool to have a vault that people really can't get into and out of. You can see that it's warded. Well, so you can't break into it. You can't pass through with the wand. So it won't work. It just stops the... And then out here, this is warded. So, can't get into the vault without going through the door. And the only person that's going to open the door is me, because I'm the one to place it. Can't break these doors without having a wand. So, I actually could pick up... The only way to pick up these doors is with a wand, and you right-click it, and that will break the door. And basically how it works is the only person that can go through the door is the person who placed it. So in here, I put my bed. I've got my personal ender chest that I carry around all the time that's matched to my ender pouch. And I put a couple of carpenter safes. So it's actually, these are also locked. So this is a double layer of security here. And of course, I've got my pop-up shelf in here in the vault. Where else would I want to have it? You can see that I've gotten my collection of tag locks in here. Figured that would be good in case anybody gets the idea that they want to steal them for nefarious purposes. I don't want nefariousness going on. All right, so that's all the stuff I did. Let's get back to doing new stuff. Wait, no, not quite yet. This thing first. In fact, I think I'm actually going to put this on this level up here. Yeah, why not? We'll put it, let's see, and it's too wide, so I can't really center it on this wall. We'll put it over here in the corner. There we go. This thing has its own interface, and there are tons and tons of really awesome decorations in here. So, to get this to work, though, it requires three different kinds of dye. These are green, red, and blue. So why you can see I got a stack of each of those. I'm going to go ahead and put those in and put that in. And the other thing that it needs in order to craft is clay. So we need some clay. You see, I went out and got a bunch of clay. Actually, let me get one more. I want to put four stacks of clay in there so I don't have to worry about loading it again for a while. Let's do it this way, make it a little bit faster. I can just drop a stack of blocks in there, and boom. You can see that it up here, it shows the clay. And, boy, that's not very much as far as the bench is, what the bench can hold. It can hold a lot of clay. So, we want to get some chain. We can search. Chain, there we go. So we got the chain top. We're going to need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of those. We're going to need the chain bottom. We're going to need 8 of those. And we're going to need the chain middle. Again, 8 of those. So we'll go down and replace our let's try something here real quick. I don't think it's going to work, but we'll see. So that would be there. Yeah. Can I possibly equal exchange these? I doubt it. No, does not work. So chain top, chain, that's the bottom, and then the middle. So why'd it go over there? Crazy. Okay, well, let's try putting the bottom one on first and then the middle. Really? Oh. Why does it not want to go there? I think there's a button you can do to like force it to go where it doesn't want to go. Like control, no. Alt, I don't know. Okay, well, enough fooling with that. It'll look good when I'm done. Obviously, it'll look better than than just having this, although not a lot better. I don't know. Anyway, I'm not going to fool with it too much while I'm recording, so I'll come back and I'm going to do a bunch of deco stuff, basically. I just wanted to put a deco bench together, so the next time you guys see the base, hopefully I'll have a bunch of decorations all throughout it. Now, if you decide that you don't like a decoration that you already made, you can go ahead and drop it back in there, and it'll put the materials back into the bench so that it can be used for other things. So you don't have to worry about like not liking something. If you don't like something, you just throw it back in there and recycle it. So isn't that wonderful? I think it's wonderful. We're gonna have lots of decorations on. Hopefully some of the sci-fi stuff and magic stuff is in there. I know there's been a lot of additions to Decocraft lately, so hopefully this is the version that has that. I guess only there's one other thing I wanted to mention about this gate while I'm looking right at it. Is I made myself a little button right here. I might remember that I was using Aaron's gate, and I went ahead and put him a piston system on that in order to turn it off easier. Now, his was underground and used a lever, but I didn't want to mess up my floor and be able to see it from below. And I came up with this. I thought this looks pretty good. It's actually centered. Then carpenter buttons can go on the bottom side of blocks. So, and I put a red anti-block in it. So red means off. So basically when I'm done using it, I just come back here, push that. It just momentarily pushes out the block at the top, which will turn off the gate, and we're good to go. Okay. Back to Atomic Energistics. Now that I've been distracted for like at least more than half the episode, get back to some Atomic Energistics. Is this thing still pumping? No. Why is it not all gone? Why is there something? Is it in there? It's all in there. It must be a visual glitch. I'm gonna guess. There's not really anything in the pipe. And if there is, it's so minuscule, it isn't gonna matter.